consistency is a very, very important property, because time and again I keep saying this, because it assures the experimentalist that as you draw more and more observations, you are getting closer and closer to the truth. That has to be assured. In fact, it turns out that there are estimators which do not conform to the consistency requirement, and a classic estimator is a periodogram. That may come as a surprise, but that statement is not complete. If I use periodogram to estimate the spectrum of a random signal, we are not talking of deterministic signals. If I use the periodogram, what is periodogram? You take the DFT, square it and divide by the sample size. That estimator does not go and sit at the truth or even get closer to the truth as you keep increasing the sample size. So, let me just illustrate. We will of course see this later on. Let us take the white noise process, right? So, let us generate, for example, 1000 observations of a Gaussian white noise process, standard Gaussian white noise. And okay, I need to. Okay. So let's plot the periodogram of this finite length realization of a white noise. What should we expect to see? What is the theoretical spectral density? Periodogram gives you empirical spectral density. Okay. So what do we expect to see? What is theoretical spectral density of a white noise? Flat, correct? You only see the base being flat. Okay, that's not a big deal, because what it says is that it is non-zero, it is non-negative valued. Is it anywhere close to being flat? So you may say, no, look, I have not taken the entire population. That is a theoretical spectral density. Okay, so then we can go back and generate, we can add 2 more zeros, so that we take 100,000 observations, and let's see if the estimate improves. Did it improve? You can't say it got worse. It's only looking more dense because the frequency spacing has come down. So the number of points on the x-axis has increased, but of course, you can say that it has not gotten better. Why is this happening? Because this periodogram estimator, you can say therefore, is not a consistent estimator. Although we are not looking at variance or we are not looking at anything else, the fact that your estimator is not getting better and better as n goes to infinity, your estimates are not improving. On the other hand, what about sample mean? You can easily show. So let us do that with the package here. So let me tell you what I am doing here. The purpose of this document is essentially to illustrate the concept of convergence and probability and so on. I do not illustrate all concepts of convergence, but let us at least look at some concepts of convergence. And our focus is on the estimation of mean using the sample mean estimator. So let us generate a Gaussian white noise realization of sample size n. So that is our reference process here, Gaussian white noise process. Let us compute the difference between sample mean and the truth, because what does convergence and probability say? Convergence and if the sample mean is convergent in probability, then the probability of finding x bar n minus the truth outside an epsilon radius should go to 0 in the limit as n goes to infinity, right? Mu is the true value, because in simulation I have to fix the truth. In theory it can be symbolic. So I have to show that, at least I have to be able to see from simulation, that the probability of this magnitude of difference being outside an epsilon radius, epsilon is an arbitrarily small number but not 0. That probability should keep shrinking. We will not compute the probabilities. You can, in fact, the package that I said, convergence concepts, that package computes the probabilities for you. It is a very simple formula. But what we will do is, instead of plotting the probability, we will just plot this difference and see whether that difference actually keeps shrinking and stays within some bounds as we increase the sample size. So, what do we have to do? We have to do three things, right? First thing is we have to generate the realization of a sample size n. That is the first step. Second step is to compute this difference for a given sample size. And three, repeat this for all possible realizations. It is impossible to generate all possible realizations. We will generate about 500 realizations and we will go up to n thousand. We can't go do this for n going to infinity. We will go from sample size 1 to 1000. Fortunately, you can do all of this in a single line in R, okay? And I've given that code here, and that code is here. So first, I set the parameters for my simulation. 1000 data points up to maximum of 1000. You can change that. In fact, n should be read as n max. M is the number of possible realizations that I'm generating here. I'm sampling 500 different points, and I'm fixing the true mean to be 2. And the number of sample paths, what we mean by sample paths is, remember this x bar is nothing but your sum estimate. For every realization, as I keep changing n, you have a path. And I am going to, so we have 500 such sample paths here. Plotting all of them will make it look very dense. We will just plot some randomly selected 50 realizations. So now, what you do is compute this difference in this single shot. Inside you have cum sum. What is cum sum doing? So it is adding up for different n, and then don't forget to divide by the length of the sequence. So that is for a single realization. Then you repeat this, that is what replicate is going to do. Then you want to arrange the results in a matrix so that each column corresponds to a realization. And when I execute this particular chunk of code, right? So let me go here and execute. So it has executed, and if everything has been done correctly, you should get this dimension, 1000 by 500. At least qualitatively, what you have done is correct. Now, what is the next step? To plot the resulting sample paths. So I am doing here the same thing. So I am just using matplot instead of using plot. Matplot works on each column. So use matplot. But do not forget to mention that you want a line plot. If you want a scatter plot on top of line, it will take time to plot. The moment you say line plot, it plots it very quickly. So let us execute this chunk here. So I will just zoom this out so that you can see what is happening. So this is the sample path that you have, as you can see. What is on the x axis? A sample size. Right, which is n. So if you are standing here, then n is 1, and you are computing the difference between x bar computed from one observation minus the truth, which is 2, and that difference obviously is going to be quite large. As I keep increasing the sample size, the distance between the estimated value and the truth keeps coming down, and different sample, I am only showing you 50 sample paths. Ideally, you should go back and do it for many, many sample paths. You can see that they are all within some bound, okay? And if you plot all the 500 realizations, there may be some outside a specified bound. I have not specified the bound here, but some differences between the estimated value and the truth can go out of bound, right? What probability, convergence in probability assures you is that the probability of finding such sample paths outside a specified bound will keep falling down as n goes to infinity. The rate at which it falls down and so on is not specified, and that depends on your epsilon also. It says that, okay, aapko ho jayega, but it does not tell you when. Whereas, the almost sure convergence can be interpreted as follows. They are not much different, but there is in one respect big difference. In almost sure convergence also, it is talking about how close the estimate is getting to the truth as n goes to infinity for all possible sequences. But it says there exists a finite sample size after which you all this ample real all the estimates will stay within a bound. But again, that doesn't tell you what is that finite sample size. Whereas the convergence in probability says it can only happen at as n goes to infinity. Whereas almost sure convergence says there exists a finite sample size. It doesn't tell you what is that, but there exists a finite sample size after which you are at truth, at the truth. So practically you may say what is the big difference, but okay, you know, it is assuring you in different ways, that's all. It is just the difference, different ways in which it is assuring convergence, what it makes them different. But all of them are guaranteeing some form of convergence. And this is the minimum requirement. Convergence and probability is the minimum requirement. Is it clear now? At least, you know, we have illustrated this for sample mean for a Gaussian white noise process. You should go and change the distribution, or you should work with a different estimator. Play around with this document. I'll post the document. Just play around, see if you know, as you increase the sample size, does it get better? If you change the distribution or some other estimator and so on. Now, the other thing that I wanted to show you through this simulation is computing bias. We have learned how to compute bias theoretically, right? What is the bias defined as? The bias is defined as expectation of theta hat minus theta naught. This is your bias. Theoretically, it may be possible for some simple estimators, but increasingly today, people are turning to simulations, Monte Carlo simulations. So, if you were to be using Monte Carlo simulators to actually compute this bias, how would you do it? What is the simple procedure? What's the simple procedure? Generate many realizations of your data. For each realization, compute a theta hat. Remember, bias is only looking for some fixed sample size. You don't have to vary the sample size, right? Bias has got, is not looking at a sample size direction at all. It is looking at the direction of realizations. So, this expectation here in simulation should be replaced with what? With averaging across many realizations, and more realizations you have, better is your calculated expected value. In this example, we have used 500 realizations, right? So, we can compute the bias. We can compute the bias, and I have done that here. And that is given in this chunk of code. All I am doing here is I am not considering small sample sizes. Remember, we have simulated from 1 to 1000 max. I am looking at sample size of 500 or more, okay? And I am plotting the bias for each sample size. Essentially, what I have to do is I have already computed the difference, right? I have already computed the difference between x bar and the truth, and all I have to do is now take the average across the realizations, okay? So, the x bar minus mu is arranged as with sample size across rows, along rows, and the each column corresponding to a realization. So, what am I doing here? I am computing the bias, right? And I am calculating the average of this x bar minus mu across realizations. Sorry? Yes. So, if I am standing at a row, I am fixing the sample size, correct? For a fixed sample size, I have to average across realizations. So, what row mean does is, actually it stands at one row and takes the mean for a row. Don't get confused with that. Row means would mean that you are standing at a row and it is looking at the average for a row. Yeah, it can be a bit confusing, but that is what row means. Okay. Fine, let us actually. So, this is the bias that you get for different sample sizes. What is the theoretical bias that we should see? Zero. Obviously, because I am averaging only across 500 realizations, So what you see on the x-axis is sample size, and I pick any sample size, it should be 0. That is what theory tells me. Regardless of the sample size, the bias is 0 because it is an unbiased estimator. On the other hand, now you should repeat this exercise for sample variance. What would happen to sample the bias and sample variance? For small sample sizes, the bias would be large, and if it is an asymptotically unbiased estimator, this bias will go and sit at 0 for large sample sizes. Okay. So play around with this document so that you understand these concepts much better. A more modern way of doing this, here we are able to generate different realizations because the data generating process is in my hand. I have an evolution equation or a random number generator. What would you do in practice? In practice, you have only a single realization. And let us say you are estimating some complicated parameter, that is some parameter which has a very complicated formula. How do you generate artificial realizations? Because the data has come from an experiment. You can't ask the experimentalist to do some 500 or 1000 experiments. It's not possible. So what you do is you turn to what is known as bootstrapping techniques. These bootstrapping techniques are very powerful today and increasingly becoming very popular. There is a whole theory around these bootstrapping techniques. The idea in a bootstrapping technique is to generate artificial realizations out of what has been given. Okay, whatever has been given, you simplest idea is, suppose I give you a realization of white noise. What you do is you resample, you collect all the observations, put them in a bag. Because it's white noise, I don't have to worry about time sequencing. I just collect all the observations of the given sample size, just put them in a bag and now start resampling. And there are two options when you're resampling. You can resample without replacement, with replacement. With replacement is recommended because without replacement can cause problems. What is that? Because the probability distribution can change. You don't want to do that. With replacement is always preferred. And there are some very nice packages in R or even in MATLAB and so on, which do the bootstrapping for you. Essentially, the idea is resampling. Okay. So that is what you use in practice. So there are three approaches to examining the properties of estimators. One is theory, but theory is useful when the estimators have simple expressions. Then simulations, when you are illustrating some concept or when you are simulating a process to generate the data. Then comes bootstrapping, which is more relevant to your practical situation where the estimator is complicated and you have only one realization of one data record. So in that order you turn to examining the properties of an estimator. Any questions on the simulation? Okay. So take this document and try it out with other, for example, you can calculate variance also in the same way as we calculated bias.